Okay. So this one, I think I'm going to call it Died Trying. There's a song out there kind of similar to that connotation, right? So anyway, it is like March. It's Friday, I don't know. March 17th, I think it is. Yesterday was the 16th. Wednesday was the 15th. Thursday was the 15th. See, people, I don't even know what day it is. It's Friday. Anyway, I printed out better drafting pleadings. I guess the pleading is the notice of claim itself. I guess that's what the pleading is, right? Because you're pleading something, you know. Please listen to what I'm trying to say. All I know is, people, Fraser Health got what they wanted. They got to fill one of those elderly care spaces at the expense of the patient. Okay? And the taxpayer. Because these non-for-profit care homes, for-profit care homes, government care homes, if you got a pension, they're taking it. And you're going to pay for the service. Okay? So the more people pay, the more beneficial it is for the ones that run that type of system. That's why John was prime realty. All right. Had good money. Was going up every year. Easy to get rid of the immediate family and take total control of his life, his brain, his assets, everything. And all it took was a pill. And a colluded group of individuals from different sectors within our society that worked together through insider trading practices that the bank wants to deny and not admit to, even though if the bank would have followed through on their contract with the enduring power of attorney, none of this would have happened. And that's the point. So is that how I put it in my amendment? Because you have to have a story, right, in order to write a notice of claim, because they want the statement of facts, right? They kind of want to know how it started, what happened, and where it's going, which is a story, right? I phoned up the bank today. The beginning of that story started in June 27th of 1990 for me, in terms of when I got back from Edmonton, Alberta, when Uncle John took a bus out there and brought me back with two of my kids. At that time, I had my two oldest ones. And I moved into a little house in Fowl Bay, in Oak Bay. And I needed a bank. I went and got myself a bank. And then 6 months later, Uncle John crying for his own bank account or whatever it was, and I took him to the same damn bank. What a mistake that was, people. That was a big mistake. Because fast forward 25 years later, the bank doesn't want to admit that it had a hand in the disappearance of my stepdad. Even though the day they closed the account was the last time I freaking seen him. Think about it. And they're making a profit from it, people. They're making a profit from it. Because his sister opened him up a savings account through a registered tax-free savings account almost immediately from the time that she took over his assets illegally, by the way. I put it down in my notice of claim so that these people on the other end knew what was going on. It's not a question of do they need to admit it or defend themselves, because it's nothing personal to that law firm that represents the bank, to the individual that went to some program copy and paste a section out of the Supreme Court Rule Act that took a total of 3 minutes to do, because they probably done it already 1,000 times to avoid accountability and transparency, right, in terms of what they do and how they affect their customers. To avoid taking responsibility for the harm that they've caused this family and to the harm that they've caused to their client, because they're making a profit, people. And let me tell you something else. If Joan Duncan, his wife, who nobody wanted to look after, who the health, Fraser Health or whatever healthcare system was sending home every fucking 2 weeks with more and more equipment in terms of feeding tubes, oxygen tanks, and all that crap, catheters, and just the whole nine yards, as she couldn't walk, people. She couldn't fucking walk. And they kept sending her home. Right? Nobody wanted her. Nobody wanted to look after her. I looked after her. Uncle John looked after her. My kids looked after her. We looked after her as a family. If she left him money through a life insurance policy, through a government superannuation, and she died in December of 2013 on the 14th day, and that family in Victoria never told him about it if he received an inheritance until they could go in and pop a bunch of pills without his knowledge or his consent, just so they could whisper behind closed doors to some corrupt social worker about how he got all this money, and they didn't want to tell him around us because they were afraid we were going to steal it? When we were the ones that went into debt for Joan and struggled with her crap in this house that they told Uncle John to throw out? And then the bank opened up another account that's over $150,000, which means that they don't technically have to tell him in a legal sense, especially if they're trying to deem him mentally incompetent, which they were, and they did it illegally because they never used the Mental Health Act to do it. Oh, they probably have now, because they think they got away with it, people. And it's already documented through other people's investigations that there's a problem in British Columbia, Canada, with people losing their assets through the Mental Health Act that's happening before they're even deemed incompetent by a registered psychiatrist in a legit freaking facility that is designated by the province, so that only that facility can put people into a mental institution, so they could take away their assets? Are you listening to what I'm saying? And the bank and whoever wants to sit up there and say that's a story? Fucking right it's a fucking story. I'll tell you why it's a freaking story. Because when I was sitting at my computer writing that story, I was telling my kids at 4 o'clock in the morning, I felt like I was writing a mystery story. I felt like I was writing a novel. Now what the heck am I writing a novel for? I shouldn't be writing a novel. There's other things I should be doing. But somewhere in my pea brain, I'm thinking, well, you know, as it goes down the assembly line from person to person to person, right? There's going to be somebody in there that has moral ethics. Somebody that takes pride in their work, right? In terms of a representative to a bank or a health authority, for that matter, right? Not every politician is corrupt. Not every union worker is corrupt. Obviously not, because the poor guy that, with his wife being restrained over there, like I said, in the same bed as Uncle John with that bell going off every 10 minutes, in an understaffed environment, right, laying up in a diaper with freaking restraints on, I'm sure he's not corrupt. But he's getting caught up in a corrupt system. So, anyway, here it says, material facts, leave me alone. I know. Then go back to your room. Go back to your room. I know. Excuse me, people. What do we expect? Grandma's always stressed out. right? So, before we get on with the material facts. So the bank, it got what it wanted. It got its registered saving plans. It's making its dividend money, you know, just by partnering up with lies, accusations, insinuations, and gossip. Right? Because that person that came in with those lies, insinuations, and gossip promised the bank, through a bribe, that the bank would make a little more money than if they just left everything alone and let Uncle John and I work out our household finances. Pay down the bills, do our teeth, you know, get the kids through school. Like I said, my daughter would have been a nurse by now, right? Perhaps my son would have been a doctor by now. I mean, he definitely had the capability to do it, but not when the brain is dying from grief. Wondering. And they may very well have banked over $150,000 without John's knowledge, because they got a reputable professional representing that account, even though if you asked him today if he'd want that money sitting where he is, which is some freaking tucked away, out of sight, never fucking find out where it's going to be, none of that, you know, just die quiet, right? And so that, you know, what's left can be pillaged by those workers, right? And if you were to find him and ask him if he wanted to, and after he realizes who he is and what his life experience, what his life experiences were, Not what they told him they were, not what they told him that he couldn't remember, that he wasn't allowed to talk about. Are you listening to me? No, they're getting paid, right? They get paid for their services not only through John's pension plan, but they also get subsidized by the government. So why do they want to rock that boat and let him come back home? They don't. Right? But if you were to ask him if he'd want $1 million sitting up in that situation, waiting for somebody to walk through his door, you know, to come visit him, one of his loving sisters, his loving adopted daughter, all those people who couldn't get rid of Joan fast enough, right? There's a reason why she came over here, because they weren't helping her people. All they wanted was her dead body and her money. And if the bank profited from that, and then wants to sit up there and say, they're not going to admit what I wrote, because it doesn't fit a rule through the Supreme Court of Canada, when you're dealing with material facts that could be a material fact, and could be confused as evidence, for the simple fact that it isn't a material fact, to tell the story, so that when you're done reading, you get a full idea of what the heck is going on. Because you're really interested in your job description. You take your job description serious in order to root out corruption when you come across it. Like, is the bank even bothering to investigate what was written down? Or are they just simply saying, we don't admit it? Is it that easy for them to get away from the problem just by copying and pasting something and putting it on a 4-page synopsis of, we don't admit it? So now I have to take all these pages and condense them down to 10. 10 pages. 200 pages to 10. And they're going to say that is going to be self-explanatory to the problem. Right? Because they got to get ready for the evidence as I submit the evidence within that 10-page synopsis of the facts, the material facts. I've been talking about the material facts for the last 2 freaking years. Okay? So, I'm not feeling well. I'm serious. I am so not feeling well. But that doesn't seem to matter. right? I think that's all part and parcel of the game. You make your victim injured, frightened, in pain, confused, obviously, because again, you know, the brain is like this. You put out 3 months of hard labor to get a slap in the face and then complete denial in terms of the insider trading practices that are going on in order to prop up a banking system and a healthcare system, right? How do I write that down, people? How do I write that down? I mean, obviously we focus on the one bank, but it's not a one bank issue, right? It's a larger issue than just one bank. One couldn't do the things that they did without the other. The other one couldn't do the things they did without the other. And then you get the middleman. And I can tell you who the middleman can be. It can either be the public guardian and trustee, or it can be an individual like John's sister who overstepped her bounds and used her professional status within the healthcare system to take advantage of the situation, because Uncle John was just like a bone, you know, give the bone to one of the leaders and corrupt the leader so that you can really go in for the meat, really go in for the kill. Because if you can turn one person's eye and make them blind, and they're supposed to be a leader within the system, then more are going to turn the eye and be blind to what's around them. And that's exactly what happened. How do I write that down? Is that evidence? And if I wrote it that way, I would put material facts to show that what I'm saying happened. And that's what I did. But because it leans more towards evidence, which is fact, right? Statement of fact. They don't want to admit it. So now I'm going to have to, like I said, bring it down to 10 or 20 pages, right? Preferably 10, because they're busy. They don't obviously have time to read. So if they can't read that, how the hell are they going to, how can you expect them to be fair and reasonable when it comes time to be in a trial setting to read what's coming? Because it's going to be the same kind of information. The only thing is I'll have a few documents to as evidence to back up that fact. Here it says, once commences a pleading by identifying the parties involved, it can be very useful to identify the relationship of the parties, particularly in complex litigation. And that's what I'm in. I'm in a very complex litigation because I'm not just dealing with one entity. I'm dealing with several. And here's another thing. Through my legal basis, now, I didn't know how they want me to write down my legal basis, so I did the best that I could, and in there, at some point, I either quoted the Criminal Code of Canada, Rules and Regulations and Acts, and court cases, in terms of reference that when it goes to court, these are things that we can rely on in order to fully discuss the matter and bring it to a freaking conclusion as to what really happened. As I'm being accused of now abusing the court system, because I want to know what happened and how it happened. What allowed these people to medically kidnap Uncle John to the point where he lost a large part of his memory? It's documented that he wasn't allowed to talk about his immediate family or see them because somebody else was making that decision for him through the facilitation of the healthcare system and the banking system that basically took away his human rights. And not only did they take away his human rights, but they took away every member in this family human rights away as well, as we continue to live in limbo, being told that we're frivolous, as they all take it to the bank. Everybody's making money off of Uncle John. And this is why I'm saying, if this doesn't freaking go through, where it's in front of an honest judge that can make an honest assessment and come to an honest decision, I will take it to the province, because I don't know what else to do other than die trying. And if it means I have to go to jail for Uncle John, I've already prepared my kids and told them, if I go to jail for Uncle John, this is what you do. Because if you're going to continue to accuse me of all these terrible things, then you might as well arrest me and put me in jail. And then maybe, just maybe, through the criminal court system that only seems to prosecute certain crimes, certainly nothing underneath the Criminal Code of Canada, because that's an obsolete book now. Right? Then I might qualify for a lawyer. I might. Considering what happened with my grandson and how I got that a lawyer approved. Which is, again, a BC Liberal government problem. Because of all their cutting and slashing of legal aid assistance and courthouses and the whole nine yards. Because they had to clear out the court so that when this baby boom comes in, there's no way to fight back. Because they go after the sick, the weak, and the meek. And I'm the perfect example of that. It's not like I can go ask for help, people, through the Fraser healthcare system. Because I'm targeted, and I've said this before. I was targeted even before I said it. I just didn't talk about it. You think I'm going to get quality healthcare? I'm not getting quality healthcare now. I haven't been getting quality healthcare for a long, long time. And if I try and put an application in for a disability, I'm told that I don't go to the doctor enough, and because I don't go to the doctor enough, crying there, give me this, and, you know, like pills and all this other crap, right, and going to the doctor every week, I don't qualify. So that's all in limbo. Everything's in limbo. Right? As previously stated, the rules require that you plead material facts but not evidence. It can be very difficult to differentiate between the two. Briefly stated, material facts are those that are necessary to prove the cause of the action. Okay, did you hear that, people? Material facts are those that are necessary to prove the cause of the action. I put down material facts to prove that what I was saying versus what I'm saying in a camera, I put it to paper and ink to prove the action, which is complicated. Evidence is the means by which you will prove those material facts. I have the evidence, people. I have it, whether it's a rule, an act, a criminal code section or whatever, right? A mandate. I have those. I have statements, right, of various kinds. I obviously got stuck with the debt load of the house, right, and the remaining bills, because I was the one that was forced within the household, not forced, obviously, but, you know, I was the one that took on the burden on top of other household chores to see us through over a period of 23 years, and I took on a sick individual, again, that nobody wanted to help, including, really, the healthcare system, unless she was willing to pay for it. And she wasn't ready to go off and into some old folks' home and be ignored. So she moved over here, and, of course, my debt load not only stayed the same, but it went up to accommodate her needs. Alright. Each element of the cause of action is a material fact. For example, in a breach of contract case, one must allege the existence of a contract. I don't have to allege it, people. I can prove it. It took me a year to get a finally final copy of The Power of Enduring, which happens to be an enduring power of attorney. Okay, enduring. There's a difference between the two, people. And the material terms giving rise to the claim and damages. So what, are they saying they have nothing on their file? In terms of who had power of attorney over that account? Because if they would have honored the contract, Uncle John would be home, basically. It would have been much harder for the healthcare part end of it for them to exploit Uncle John to the point where they got him nicely tucked away like their dirty little secret. Right? As they're accusing me of being abusive. After 2 years. Because they don't know what else to say. How the defendant breached the contract. I proved that, people. I proved that. I proved that through my notice of claim. As a material fact. Only because I have the evidence at home. To back up that material fact. Which is scandalous. For the bank. How the defendant breached the contract and that the plaintiff suffered damages as a result. I wrote down the damages, but they're not acknowledging them. Isn't that interesting? So anyway, I don't know. All I know is this stuff is making me sicker. All I know is I can't go to the doctor and ask for help. All I know is I can't get my teeth pulled, so I live with pain that just makes me sicker every day. All I know is I'm stuck with all the bills, high gas, high rent, right? You know, things falling apart around here, not getting fixed properly in a timely manner. Now, mind you, my landlord went to India. But even still, you know, they're kind of accumulating. There's a couple of things here that need to be done, and which means they're hinting around for more rent. I already paid $1,700. I sure in the hell can't afford to move out of this place because I can't afford to go anywhere because there's nowhere you can afford to live anymore, right? But as the washing machine needs to be fixed, as the light, you know, socket there needs to be changed, as my back window needs to be replaced, you know, those, as the water tank needs to be serviced, that all adds up, and then my landlords get mad at me because, you know, for some reason I'm supposed to pay for this stuff, right? And if I don't pay for it, then I end up paying for it with the increase in rent because, you know, blah, 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 same old political blah, 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 right? So, you know, like, I'm on borrowed time, people. I'm like literally on borrowed time. Okay? That's why I say die trying. You know, my landlord talks about how he's got heart problems and he's on borrowed time or bonus time. It's his bone, like he's in his 70s and he's always afraid. Well, he's not afraid. He's trying to face it with, you know, bravery. That with heart problems, you know, he could die at any moment, right? So he's on bonus time. Well, I don't feel like I'm even on bonus time. I feel like I'm on borrowed time. Borrowed. Right? Because I'm not going to drop the ball. I want to, and that's why they do it, right? That's why they do it, because they know 9 times out of 10, people are going to drop the ball, right? That's why they want you to go to the doctor and go get a whole bunch of pills and go on long-term disability popping those pills so that they can continue doing what the fuck they do. And if you don't play it their way, start taking all the damn pills, they just kick you off to the curb and find another way to attack you. So, anyway, that's what's going on. That's what's going on. So I gotta take 200 pages, 250 pages, bring them down to 10 pages. And even then, they'll find something wrong with it and say something that they can try and worm and weasel their way out of it. Right? That's what's going to happen, even if I spend the next 3 weeks, assuming that I even have 3 weeks. Because I don't know what that 35-day period is between the pleading process. I mean, this could be it. Right now, from the time I served it to the time they answered. And now I've only got like 10 days left. Could you imagine? And then it's going to get thrown out of court because I couldn't amend it within that 10-day period because I'm still trying to figure out... I'm still trying to figure out how to freaking do it right within their language. I thought that thing wasn't working. I was going to take out the batteries and... But I guess it's working. It's been sitting here for like a month. All of a sudden, this just goes off. Now, isn't that interesting? Rock around the world tonight, all the way around the world, right? Well, I guess that's what I'm doing, people. I'm rocking. And I don't know. So I'm just... That's it. That's just a little mini update, okay? That's what's happening. You can hear it. I'm having a nervous breakdown. Oh, yeah. As for this nonprofit, too, it's going out the door, people. Because I'm worn out. I mean, obviously, it's not going out the door tomorrow, but having to put all my energy into this bureaucratic corporate pool of bullshit. Right? I mean, it's one thing when you're trying to promote a universal school meal program and youth programs and housing programs and those kind of programs in a province that doesn't want it on a political level in terms of a ruling body. Okay? And money-hungry grubs running around in the community, got to have all, you know, their portfolio with 7 different pension plans and the superannuation life insurance policy and, you know, money coming in from some other source because they were able to manipulate the system over there and steal somebody else's money. So that just adds a little more to the portfolio. You know what I'm saying? That's the kind of province I live in, people. Uncle John warned me. He told me those people that work in the Parliament building and people like them, right, that came in from different sectors within our society before they actually, you know, some were lawyers, some were social workers, some were this, some were that, and then all of a sudden they became a politician. Well, it's not about representing your constituency. It's about how many of those pension plans they can put in their portfolios. And that's what Uncle John told me because he worked there for 25 years. Remember, he was a janitor. So that's why this stuff goes on. Because it doesn't affect them directly, right? Outside of making their portfolio get thicker and thicker and thicker, right? Because there's kickbacks to that kind of stuff, right? What was I going to say? Oh, yeah, nonprofit. So, needless to say, you know, like, this one board director that quite possibly could make a difference, he asked me to photocopy some bylaws and, you know, that type of stuff, right? And, like, I haven't even done it yet, people. I haven't done it. Like, I'm so worn out. Like, I am so worn out. I wake up, my body hurts. For whatever reason, I'm thinking, I miss vinyl floors. I really miss, I want vinyl floors back. This hard cream stuff is terrible, and I'm on it all day long, and then have to walk on these awful, god-awful, what do you call these things? They're not hardwood, but, you know, they're the laminated kind of like hardwood floors that are just dust magnets. That's all they are. They're just dust magnets and crumb magnets. And, you know, and you walk on that all day long, you know, with a fluorescent light that doesn't have a proper cover on it, right? Like, there's something is just making me ill on top of the stress, right? Obviously, the chloma is a problem, right? And it's not like I feel 100% safe and confident and comfortable, you know, seeing eye doctors any more than any kind of freaking doctor at this point, right? Because my eyes didn't get worse until I started seeing eye doctors. My nose didn't start running and have this pressure in my eyes and in my head and all this other stuff until I started seeing the eye doctor in November of 2012. throw in the stress with Andre by June and July of 2013. That was it. Everything just started to fall off the grid and go off the roof. That's what I mean by die trying. Right? Huh? So it's not like I can promote the nonprofit that much. I'm too busy trying to defend myself against things that I'm still being accused of, and I'd like to know what the hell it is in writing. And if I have to, I'll go, like I said, and you charge me, I'll go in front of a judge, and I'll get a lawyer, and we'll determine whether I'm guilty or not. Right? At least we'll get to the truth of the matter as whether Uncle John is still alive or not. Whether the bank took a big bribe money, like I said, and opened up an account over $150,000 without his knowledge, as if he would have cared, because he wouldn't have. Because if he would have cared, he would have asked in that 13-month period, did Joan leave money? Did Joan leave money? Where's her will? I want to see her will, because I want to make sure she didn't leave money. But he didn't care about the money, so he never asked, because he thought his family would do the right thing if she did. But we need to know the truth, right? We need to know the truth, because for Uncle John to lose his immediate family the way he did and be tucked away like a dirty secret so these people can protect their interest dividends and their paychecks and their freaking, you know, tax, you know, money coming in on a provincial level. Right? We should find out the truth, really. If how much is involved here versus just his pension plans that pay for his service that he never wanted. As people are running around saying, we didn't do it. It's not us. John moved himself to Victoria all on his own. He got up out of that wheelchair and he walked himself to the ferry and he walked on the ferry and he walked himself to the Victoria General Hospital. He admitted himself under duress. And then he has to stay there and talk to nobody ever again in Victoria or in Vancouver. All so that he could be a rich man. And sit in a dirty diaper all fucking day long waiting for somebody to come visit him. Like, that's perverse. Do you honestly think a man would choose that for himself? Knowing that he's not even being told the truth about what the hell is going on around him? How do you write that down in a notice of claim? You tell me. I'm going to have to go downtown and figure that out. And if I don't do it right with the bank, and if I don't do it right with the health authority, well, by time three times comes around, it's like, you know, when you're at the bat, right? You know, strike three, you're out kind of thing, or you walk. Maybe this is just the prelude for the provincial government, right? Maybe I shouldn't see it like such a failure that I can't get through to these people and be fair about my notice and claim in terms of giving them the information that they need to follow up on the corruption that's within the system. Because they take pride in their work. Versus being a gangster. You know, everybody's got to be a gangster. Always pointing their finger at that gangster, but never at themselves. Right? Like, I'm going into a lockdown, like into an emotional lockdown here. It's like, it's so hard to discipline myself to, okay, I know what I need to do. I got to take 200 pages, bring it down to 10, omit this, omit that, omit, 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 and hope that the truth comes out. Hope that it comes out. But after you admit, omit, omit, not admit, omit. After you would omit 98% of it, just to appease the criminal what do you think the result's gonna be? Huh? What makes 2% more important than the other 98%? And even if they were lenient and gave me 5%, what makes that the most important out of the whole other 95% that's being omitted? That's what I'm struggling with right now. And then I have to force myself to sit there and rewrite it as I'm being humiliated. Right? As I'm being, you go write something as you're being humiliated. You go write something as you being accused of shit for the last 2 years, okay? You go write something knowing that you're not feeling well, but you can't go ask for help because you don't know who you can trust within that system because it's all queued through their computers. You understand what I'm saying? It's queued through their computers before you even walk through the door. If they're not watching you walk down the street, listening to your conversations with their spyware, not saying that that's what's happening, but it does happen. And if it's happening somewhere, it's happening somewhere else. They know where you're going. And when you get there, because there's so much staginess going on, because it's, you know, it's big money, 20 years of nonstop freaking herd of wealth. You're not going to want no too many interruptions with that. I'll go limping back to the courthouse so that I can remove 95% of material facts that need to be written down in order to understand the story so that there is a story around the notice of claim, the pleading. So they can come back with their copy and paste response to play the same card 100 times over, assuming that 99 other people went in there and sued for the same crap. When in reality, most people don't because they don't have the stamina to do it. And that's why they do it. Okay. Oh yeah, nonprofit. I don't know what's going to happen with nonprofit. I don't know. I'm torn between doing some nonprofit stuff or obviously having to put an amendment in, which is more than likely not going to be sufficient in terms of the way they want it submitted through their language. Okay, people, now it's March 16th, 2017. Here's that pea soup. You can see what I'm doing. You know, practicing what I preach. I'm not always good at it, but I'm working on it, okay? So anyway, I took half of this for now. I'm not interested in thick soup, okay? I want something a little more slurpy. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do it this way. There goes that screen. I don't know if this is working, people. Hold on a minute. Oh. There we go. Okay. So we're going to just warm this up on warm. I have a half a tomato that's been sitting in my fridge for a while. So I'm just going to chop that up. Put that in there. Like I said, today I'm craving something slurpy. with a little bit of fiber in it. You can see what I'm doing here, right? So you can adjust the consistency of your soup to what it is that your mind is desiring at the time. See, this made it a little better, right? And then as it cooks, I'll add in a little bit of, what do you call it? Chopped tomato, you'll see. Okay, so we're going to warm that up. I took out some chicken actually on that day. It was frozen. So it's what? We're going into the third or fourth day here, whatever it is. I highly recommend people that you vacuum seal your food when you freeze them. Because when you unthaw them, this is what I've noticed, and I'm an experienced mother. Okay. What I've noticed is you put it in the fridge, it's frozen. You get busy, as mothers do, or anybody for that matter. And then you forget about it. And it's like 3-4 days later, like, oh, I put that in the fridge and it unthawed. Oh. If it's not vacuum sealed, I've noticed that they spoil faster in terms of sitting in the fridge like that. If it's vacuum sealed, chances are I'm going to cut this open and it's going to be perfectly fine. Because you'll smell it if it's gone bad. Right? If it was just in a bag that was loosely whatever, and you know, take out as much as you can, throw it in the fridge, freezer, and then put it in the fridge, the unthaw, and forgot about it 4 days or whatever, chances are, because it's not vacuum sealed, it's going to spoil much faster. So anyway, I'm going to take this, now that I remembered about it, and I'm going to put it in this lovely container, frying pan, because I got into my cupboards, right? Remember? Uh-oh, there goes the screen again. Hold on. See, I don't want to be talking and then thinking that it's not filming because I can't see. I'm trying. There we go. Okay. I can only tell it's recording by the record sign. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put a little bit of oil in there. Just a little bit. I'm going to start with the chicken because it's got some fat on it. So we'll get some chicken fat going. Right? I'm going to rinse off these beans. Right? And then technically I should be cooking the beans first. I don't know. I want to cook 1 cup of beans in here. I'm going to rinse them off first, okay? And then at some point, I'm going to do the chicken, whether I take out the beans and then do the chicken separate. I'm not really too sure what I want to do. I just know that I'm going to cook those two up. And then as I'm going through my food storage, I came across some rock salt whole. Oops, sorry. This is a product of India. So this is salt from India. You can see it's a little different. I haven't opened up the jar or the bag yet, so I'm going to open it up today and I'm going to taste it. And then I'm going to put it in this little container. Okay? And then anytime you can find yourself a little deal, you know, don't be afraid to take it, right? Especially if it's this kind of stuff, because this kind of stuff can last a very long time past its due date. Just when in doubt, think of you know, biblical sayings where they, you know, go in 7-year cycles. Right? You store your food for 7 years and you harvest for 7 years. Right? Obviously it's going to go maybe a little more, a little less, but it's usually a 7-year cycle. So this is good for quite a few years. And because it's a wheat, right? Yeah, maybe not so much as a plain flour, but it's fine because I've had these before. And so anyway, for a buck, for me, economically, it was worth it, right? And you're getting 100% wheat. Right, same thing with these. Got it for $1. The store where it was selling, regular $3.49. I guess if you go to a major food chain, you're going to be looking at something similar, $2.99, $3.50. Right, pretty much the same amount of money. So I got that for $4. That for $1. So that is $5. Right, and this would be creamy tomato soup. So, in that situation, maybe I'd make some rice, and then as the rice cooks, or whatever, you know, I could put that in there, and that would be nice with rice. So, hold on a minute. Okay, so, moving along, this is our first cup of beans. Only 1 cup, people. Again, if family's not that large, and if they are, they come and go in batches, like I said before, right? So, what I did is I just took 1 cup of white beans, kidney beans, and I just put some, rinsed them off, and put them in the water here, brought it to a boil, took it off the heat, took it off the burner, and I'm just going to let it sit here. There we go. I'm just going to let it sit here and just soak for a while, okay? If you soak your beans the night before, it helps to cut down on gas within the bean itself. In this case, I'm not soaking anything. I'm kind of just cooking, so I'm kind of doing a quick soak, right? Before I throw them into this container. Here's that soup. I started to heat it up. This is the kind of consistency that I'm looking for to replace the amount of coffee and tea that I'm drinking right now with the same amount of sugar as I normally do, right? There's those tomatoes, little bit of tomato that was in my fridge. So when I'm ready, as this is cooking, I'm going to taste it, put my salt in there, whatever, because I haven't put no salt or pepper in there. This is straight from what I've already made, right? And then as the day goes by, you know, if you eat this and you want more, you can always add more to the pot, add a bit more water, put the lid on, keep it on low, you know, make sure the lid can breathe there just so it's on an angle, right, like this. Otherwise, you'll boil it even on low because this is one of those cast iron pots, right? And then you have this for all day, right? And then chicken is fine. Here's some old food storage, people. This one was due 2013. I have several more containers of these tucked away. I've been using them, as you can see, right? Obviously, once I open them, I put them in the fridge, right? But when they're in storage, I just put them off to the corner, darken, you know, try and put them in. I like to tend to put things on the north side of the house because the north side and north walls are always colder than the south. Just remember that. Here's that salt. I tasted it. It's very good. It makes me think of Andre, when we're going to start doing some volcanoes and making planets, right, which we'll be doing hopefully in the next couple, 2-3 weeks. Obviously, I have a lot of paperwork I have to do, so, you know, I'm going to be going downtown and sitting in the library with a sign asking for help as I try and figure out how to amend what I need to amend. But as I look at this, it just makes me think that when I start my project with Andre, I'm going to, you know, because we're going to start talking about rocks and minerals, and because he has an old computer program from when my kids were little, like Andre's age. They're all coming upstairs and they're looking at all these little CD programs that Andre's playing on, and they go, I remember that. I used to play that. Like, they've all come up and pretty much said the same thing, right? I remember that. I used to play that when I was a kid, when I was your age, and Andre's 6, so that shows you how long I've had those CDs for, right? So in the meantime, I've already started to do this. So what we're going to do is we're going to throw the chicken in there. And it's cooking away already, I can see it. And I'm going to grind up that salt. Ooh, not a good idea, people. Jeez. Now here's the problem with my counter space. If you notice, I don't got a lot of counter space. I'm just going to turn this down for a few minutes. Right? And there's my cupboard. So when I have anything cooking here, if it's liquid or grease or whatever, it goes up and through here, right? Up and through here. So that's why I want to hang that cloth. Plus, I need to make it something so it holds this cupboard, because I hung that there, this stuff, these pots, right? So they tend to make the cupboard door come, right? So I just have a hook on it, but I need to make it where it's flush and then put that fabric in there so that it keeps the grease or the moisture from a soup or whatever I'm cooking on this one little particular counter here, right? So anyway, we've got that started, and then I'm going to crush this up, I guess, in that. And I'm going to salt that, and we're going to let these soak for a while. Hold on a minute, we'll be back. Okay, so now we're looking at this salt. You can see it. Now, I would think that there is iodine in this, people. Because iodine is what? Like a maroon or burgundy? Hold on here. Hold on. Okay, so here's some iodine. Where am I? There it is. Do you see? I had to open the container. That's why. Look at this, people. Do you see the color? Oops, sorry. Oh, there goes the screen. Okay. Hold on. I gotta make sure this is still working. It kicks out on me, right? Do you see the color? Do you see the color? I would definitely say that this rock salt from India has iodine. And this is why the Punjabis favor it so much. When my landlords go to India, if they can get salt from India, from their specialty stores, they do. But look how beautiful that is. Do you see that? So, anyway, we'll be talking about that with Andre when the time comes to work on his volcanoes and planets and that kind of stuff. I ground that stuff up. There it is right there. I know it's not the best plate, but you can see it. I think it's been well established that it has iodine. Two colors are very similar, if not equal to each other. So, I'm going to take some of this salt, and I'm going to put it on this chicken. That's what I'm going to do. Great. Okay. Now, this is old ginger sliced. So, for some flavor, I'm just going to put it in there as is. And we'll put the lid back on as is. And I'm going to just start simmering it for a while. Okay, so the beans absorbed a bit of the water, then I just rinsed them. Now I'm putting them in here. This little electric frying pan works really well. I'm extremely surprised. I have to take out those because they were crisping up, but that's okay. I'm going to put them back. Put them back in there because it's just the flavor anyway, right? Just going to stir that around for a little bit. Just spitting. It's not even on 250. It's quite the little unit. Put on, yeah, it's about 225 or 250. Anyway, and then after that, you can see this is the consistency that I kind of want for today. Right, so I'm just going to let that be like that for a while. Just put it on low, keep it on low. I'm not going to put the tomatoes in right now because I kind of want them not fully cooked, right? When I'm ready to eat the soup myself. And plus, I want a few beans. So I'm just going to keep that on warm. Going to add some pepper. And I'm going to add a different salt. That's the other salt. That's not the Himalayan salt. That's the other salt. Because every salt has its own taste, right? And I really like this stuff. And I eat a fair... As much sugar as I eat almost as much salt. Well, maybe not as much salt. But I eat a fair amount of salt. Anyway. So you can see what I'm doing here, right? So we're just going to put that in there for a while. Right? Let those beans soften up. We're just going to cook it that way. I just wanted to kind of get some of that chicken juice out. Right? Just get it started. And I'll probably end up cutting it, breaking it up in two, and then I'll put the lid on it and just simmer it and get these beans cooking so that when I'm ready for my soup, if I want, I can take some cooked beans from there and just add it to the soup. Same is true for the chicken. Or I can leave everything in there and always make some rice later. Or maybe my son will come home and would like some beans because he likes beans, right? He's a lumberjack, right? So he's not picky, that one. Right? He's kind of outgrown soup. He says when he was a kid, he only ate it because I made it. But now that he's older, he doesn't necessarily want to eat it like he used to eat it because I used to make soup all the time. But that's not to say that at some point in the future, if I can get into the routine of this again like I used to, especially if I can come in with some different kind of soups like minestrone and, you know, cream broccoli and cream cauliflower soup, which is Uncle John's favorite soup, cream cauliflower soup, right? Or mushroom soup. Homemade mushroom soup is nice. And then there's borscht, right? There's all kinds of soups that you can make, right? So anyway, this is what I'm going to do now. So I'll be back. Hold on. Okay. So I took a nap. Obviously, I'm not feeling very well, people. So anyway. These are nicely done now. They were cooked, and then I turned it down. I went to sleep for a bit with Andre. And do you see, if you want a little more fiber, just put it in there, right? I'll try and give him a couple, see if he'll eat them. He may not eat them, but he might. Hopefully he will. Alright, do you see that? Oops, sorry. That's a very good soup, people. The consistency.